So I'm Jacinta.
Hi, Jacinta. I'm Taylor.
Hey, I'm Christine. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
So to start, would you tell us a little bit about yourself, your name, where you're from, and your personal background?
I'm sculptor Taylor Pilote. I was originally born in Niagara Falls, Ontario, Canada. I grew up in a small town called Fort Erie, which borders Buffalo. I grew up as a drawer and painter. I was lucky enough to have two hardworking, self-employed parents that kind of gave me a nice work ethic. They were both craftsmen as well. That set me kind of on a path of being more of a creative, do-it-yourself kind of person. My dad was a body man by trade, still is. I grew up pretty much literally in his shop. So I guess my first interaction with form and color and material working came directly from interaction with him.
So you spent a lot of time sort of in an automotive shop. Could you tell us how that's translated into your current studio practice and sort of what a regular day looks like for you in the studio?
Spinning off of that, I went to school for automotive engineering to start. I had the grades to get into engineering school, and I was kind of strayed and told not to kind of go down the path of starving artist. After a year of that, I said, I'm switching over. And like I said, I was drawing and painting at the time, went into undergrad, had to take sculpture classes as part of your preliminary, and those technical skill set just transferred over, and there was like no changing back. So fast forward, you know, 15 years now, I'm in the studio. I guess you can see in the background that I have some work up here. This is my studio, actually. I also set up this kind of Andrew Cuomo PPE stack of things that you guys helped me pay for getting these sculptures continually going. And so my day currently, I stay at home with my son. I have a 6-month-old. So my wife is lucky enough to still have her job and she's at home. So I'm doing daddy duty during the day. And then when I walk my dog at night, I come to the studio for 3 to 5 hours, do some work, and then return with the dog at home afterwards. So my day, as far as what the studio looks like, I work specifically most recently with aqua resin, which I started in my dad's body shop with fiberglass, which is a very similar but more toxic version of what I'm using now. So the aqua resin is a water-based, not resin-based, but it uses the same fibers. So it's very, very similar, and it transferred pretty much one-to-one, and I can use it exactly as I was taught to use fiberglass growing up with a little chemistry in there. So they start kind of as a form modeled around an idea of either a make or model of a car or an idea of the car or motorcycle. I've made a couple pieces recently that are motorcycle based, go through a series of sketches and figure out how to best use expensive materials in the most efficient way. And then kind of from there, my sketches end up battling back and forth, and the material ends up telling you really what you can and can't do. And so that leaves way for like happy accidents and things that you couldn't necessarily engineer into a piece, which kind of gives it its own life coming from there. So like this piece in the back with this fiberglass and the fleece, can soak the fleece in the resin and then make it fold and fall the way I want or the way it wants. And then it hardens in 20 to 30 minutes, depending on how much accelerator I use. So that's what I'm saying about letting that kind of do what it does on top of me forcing it, trying to do a dance with the material.
I know that you're caring for your 5-month-old during the day, but is there anything you're doing to stay creative right now or a specific piece that you're working on you'd care to share?
I guess I can share both. My most current piece is this piece in the corner here. There, I'm pointing correctly. That I'm actually making kind of an homage piece. My father-in-law passed away recently. It's based on a model of car that he had, and it intertwines kind of nicely. So I guess with the way I go about choosing the model and why I'm choosing that vehicle or things, I can get into that a little bit. So like the chrome emblem there, I spent a lot of time scouring like Craigslist and Facebook Messenger now, which seems like so wrong for me, but it works. So that piece specifically is from like a 49 DeSoto, and the emblem is a conquistador. It's like a helmeted Spanish kind of explorer, and my father-in-law was an avid traveler, and it just found to be fitting that he had this car for no really sentimental reason, that had this monument of a of an explorer on it, and kind of how his life evolved. He kind of infamously thumbed his way, like hitchhiked down through South America, only to kind of get like sidetracked by amoebic dysentery. So there's like layers of the onion that unfold in these pieces. And like, you know, upon first inspection, you look at it as a like pretty well-built, purpose-built, not necessarily representational sculpture, but then there's like other layers of this that come out after you're kind of drawn into a beautiful object that you don't as a viewer necessarily have to know or ever figure out, or you can bring things to that as well. But that's what I'm currently working on. Your other question was, while I'm at home, what's happening? It's interesting because it gives you this virus. My wife's in public health, so I understand very thoroughly what's going on, and maybe have a more inside track on some of the dangers and things like that. So we're obviously being very careful. I guess at the most part, it allows you kind of to slow down and figure out what exactly you want to be doing, what projects, you know, need to be. I have a full sketchbook of projects that are on deck, but like, which one is the next? Why does that one have to be made? So it allows you to slow down. I think I've been reading a lot, which is good, because a lot of times you want to get done work or your other obligations and get to the studio and just make a lot of things. So sometimes being tied up all day, I've been finding myself making small notes on my phone about prioritizing what needs to get done so that I can be a little bit more efficient in the studio. So that really helps. I just finished a book by Bridget Mayer. She has a gallery in Philly. I'm not originally from Philly, so I'm still learning, you know, whoever everybody is and what's going on. So I just finished her book, but there's a lot of, it's called The Modern Artist's Way. There's a lot in it that kind of makes you look at the artistic practice as like a holistic situation where you're understanding like why you're reading what you're reading, taking time to do things that aren't necessarily just studio. And there's like the joke going around that you're artist, you can't like emerge from your studio and you didn't understand that there was like a pandemic even going on because you're kind of so blinders on and in your studio and doing things. But it talks about, like I was saying, holistically where you're, you know, what you're reading and the things you're doing outside of the studio to make it a full practice, whether it be finances and working on how you can physically make it happen monetarily, family life, things like that. So I think the reading, a lot of research, a lot of Craigslist searching, a lot of Facebook marketplace searching for parts and pieces and things. Sometimes it's as simple as that to figure out what next project bins into fruition.
You use the terminology car based and motorcycle based. I find that really, really interesting, actually. Maybe this will sort of tie into talking about a specific piece, but one of the pieces you submitted is slab side slide. Mm-hmm. And I'm just curious about how this terminology, like car based or motorcycle based, sort of plays into these pieces. And maybe you could talk about that piece specifically.
That piece I made, I think, is 2014. It's a black floor based piece. It's a 49 Ford rear quarter panel and taillight. I like to think of it as like my pieces are a slow demise. So like they're kind of withering away, but there's kind of this, there's this mite of holding on to. And so it's kind of like slumped over its own tire, pretty sleek black. I get a lot of like Darth Vader talk about people that look at it from the viewer's perspective. So slab side, so post-war vehicles coming off of a very direct design influence from airplanes. Cars, you know, prior to this, what they call a shoebox Ford, had very specific fenders and rear fenders, and the body was thinner. The slab side, they call these cars slab sides because they literally, those became one piece. Fenders through doors through the back. So that car specifically was termed more by enthusiasts. They call it a slab side or a shoebox Ford. So that's how it ties into like every decision there is to make while making these objects. There's like an opportunity to like inject a little bit more information, whether the viewer needs or wants to dig that deep. Like there's possibilities for adding information. So things like that, it's an odd name, but if anybody were to ask, it kind of starts unfurling into the deeper meaning or ties to the reference subject.
Another question we have for you is, in what ways do you think art and artists are beneficial during this time?
You know, I think that kind of goes back to what I was saying about Bridget's book and looking at our studio practice, maybe more under a microscope currently outside of what actually happens in the studio and being a little bit more holistic. I think there's benefits to being forced to not make if you're a person who has a hard time not making. So like for me, like material and technical ability, I don't necessarily fully look at like it as a crutch, but I think it can become a crutch where you're making things because you can make them and then you kind of snowball into this next thing, next thing, next thing. Or next show, next talk, next, you know, residency, things like that. Whereas being at home and like being forced, like I was saying earlier about thinking about finances or I don't know, I run Pilote Studios here. So I offset my cost of my studios to rent to other people. Like maybe even just thinking about if your studio situation is right for you, are you in the right size? Are you spending too much? Do you need more space? Like I was just talking to someone last night about that and a building's closing down. And I understand that happens, you know, without any notice or without knowing that you're going to be output, you know, maybe really thinking about, is that the place we need to be? You know, it could be a nice turning point for someone that was like unsure maybe about why they were doing what they were doing, or, you know, am I tied into this just because of a lease, or is it really good for me? You know, we're forced to hole up now outside of our studios. I guess in reading Bridget's book, it kind of spurred me to shore up other areas of, you know, whether it be my bookkeeping or sketching a lot more, writing a lot more. Also like, just spending time. I have a 6-month-old, so it's like spending tons of time with him is awesome. But I think with this book, it's not necessarily dead on an artist's book. So there's a lot of references and people that she interviews across disciplines that are successful about thinking about their businesses as a whole. And I think it's tough to think of your artistic practice as a business, not a hobby, because we toe that line between, am I going to get paid for anything, or am I just a full expense to myself? So I think there are areas, you know, that you can shore up and push towards that business aspect that maybe just get towed along with the line if you can't stop and think about them. So I've been trying to take the time to do that.
Seems you have accomplished quite a lot artistically, both in a community and on a personal level, but what is your dream project?
When I read that question, I was like really thrown aback. And I don't want to continually go back to Bridget's book, but I literally finished it last week. You know, she talks about thinking about a 5-year and a 10-year and goals outside, because I think like I was talking about earlier, you get into a snowball and like you're thinking about like next 4 minutes, like, can I get lunch in? Can I, you know, what's the next show? Things like that. So I've been thinking about a lot of larger things. I mean, I want to have an installation in the Venice Biennale. That would be a monster project. And I have, you know, I make a lot of wall-based work like this, but I have bigger, more far-reaching things kind of on deck waiting for either, you know, you wait for logistics to come together or like funding, obviously, or like the right place to unveil something like that. So the Biennale would be crazy. But I am working on a larger project down in Tampa. I did my grad school at the University of South Florida, and I'm working with a collective down there called Crab Devil, and they have secured a space, funding, and plans for something along the lines of Meow Wolf in Santa Fe. And so they're building like this shipping container immersive art maze. You essentially work your way through space through shipping containers, and it's a big conglomeration of, I don't know, like 40 or something. So I was one of the first, I don't know if there was 10 or 13 people to get their project accepted, which is cool. It spins off of a project that I did in 2012, which was called They See Me Rollin', which is it's like a General Electric normal dryer that I retrofitted with a 20-inch rim that perpetually spins. It's custom painted and a bunch of things. So essentially this is a massive wall of dryers fit with these rims that perpetually spin, like you would see in your like neighborhood laundromat, but like cut open the side of a shipping container. So I don't know how many, we haven't really figured out how many are actually going to happen, but that's like on the next level of like, you know, getting bigger and having the opportunities and the funding to figure out how to actually make things like that happen outside of your studio. Because I've always been somebody who does everything myself, like from start to finish. So it's really interesting when you get, you know, I can still build that thing, but like there's a lot more moving parts and working with other people and things like that. So that project, I'm really looking forward to that.
A question that we would love to know is if there's an artist that you're really excited by right now or inspired by.
I always go back to these really interesting videos of Federico Salmi. He makes these like they're immersive projections of videos that are computer generated animations. And I think in this kind of weird, uncertain time, you know, with COVID thing and also like presidential uncertainty, I think when this all started rolling downhill, I guess you would say, and you know, we were locked up and we're watching a lot of news updates, and then you're watching like primetime presidential addresses and things. I think that, you know, if you cross over to these videos that I'm talking about, and it's hard to explain something that you're not looking at, but there's one video from 2017 called The Conspirators. So Federico Salmi, S-O-L-M-I, I believe. Sorry if I'm butchering that. But I think they're really interesting, like immersive, almost overstimulation. They're pretty awesome. I guess sculpturally, I just picked up a book of old Ed Keenholtz work. So he has like, I initially looked into it because he has a piece called Backseat Dodge 38. And it was like made in the 60s or something. But I found a book that incorporated that, and it kind of like looks into these voyeuristic vignettes, sculptural vignettes that are kind of on the larger scale, kind of Robert Gober-esque, maybe a little bit. But then sculpturally, like I look in on what Aaron Curry is doing. I think his work kind of swings from really formal Donald Judd era work all the way to things that are, you know, really cutting edge and fun, and like the paint finishes and things are kind of what I would never do to some of my work, or maybe I should try to do to some of my work. So I think that's always interesting to see like how that's been changing over my career.
What advice would you give to artists, or what's the best advice that you've ever been given?
The best piece of advice that I got was from an artist, really accomplished, awesome artist, multidisciplinary artist, Ian Baxter And. He added an ampersand to the end of his name. So he's Ian Baxter Ampersand. Awesome guy. When I was leaving undergrad, he was a professor emeritus there. And I had a couple painting classes with him. And then we worked with directed studies together. He said that, he goes, you know, we as artists are really weird and we're really quirky. And those quirks, like, they're not all the same. They're not predictable. And he told me that, he said, you need to find someone, the person you marry you have to find someone who understands this quirkiness and weirdness and allows it to happen in a way that promotes, you know, weird material purchases I make, or odd pieces of cars that, you know, never should be resurrected, or things like that. And, you know, I have to say that my wife is awesome, Kara, with that. She's, you know, I did that. So I'm very, very happy. So that was an awesome piece of advice, because she completely allows me to do some wild things in the studio here, which is great. I don't give advice, but my dad used to talk about people who lie when the truth will do, and to not trust people that will lie when the truth will do. So I think that as that pertains, like in the context of my practice, is like staying true to yourself. Because I, you know, I had some pretty good success with some of these works that were more manageable, like things that hang on walls. Like somebody can go into a gallery and see like, oh, I can buy this because I can hang this like a painting. Like I understand, like I don't have to move my couch and put this dryer in my, you know, office kind of thing. So I think, yes, staying true to myself as to what the next project is and why, and going and not lying when the truth will do, because when it all boils down to it, you are the person who's going to be talking to the person, and the truth never lies.
That is solid advice. Thank you. If there was money wasn't an issue and your house would fit to whatever piece you would want, what piece of art by what artist would you love to live with?
Yeah, so this was very hard as well. So I just went with like initially what I thought, and like the kid in me, Motorhead kid. And I think Chris Burden's Big Wheel, it's like from, I think it's from the 70s, 71 or something. I saw it in 2013 at his show at the New Museum. That show was called Extreme Measures. So basically what it is it's like a 1968 motorcycle, a Benelli single cylinder, 250cc motorcycle that spins this 5,000 pound pulley. So this little motorcycle gets fired up and spins, you know, ends up being the power to spin this big pulley that pulled out of like a coal mine from the 1800s or something. So it's like 5,000 pounds of pulley with this person riding it, like with the wheel, like right on their back, it's like 5,000 pounds rotating at 200 RPMs is like ridiculous power. Like if that thing lets loose, the whole building's coming down. But like we're all standing like 5 feet from it, right? Or it was just amazing that the way the thing ran and the immenseness of like what could go wrong, how like not that loud and not that fear inducing it was. It was a really interesting experience, especially seeing other people. And like, I never know what other people think or if they're thinking that things could go wrong or they're just expecting these things to work correctly. But like the danger is immense. And I think that understanding that is awesome. So having that, I mean, if we were locked in, you know, I could tinker with it, I could fix it, I could run it, I could, like, I think that there was like, there's utility in a few different ways that could spend time with that piece, but also you could just like let it run. And it's like, you know, I try not to use the word awesome as well as many times, but like awe inducing that piece for sure is. But it also completely ties like my lowbrow, my dad's shop with my highbrow art interests. And those things, I think I continually try to research people and pieces of artwork that allow those things to happen together fluidly without forcing it. So I think that's also why it's a good choice, I think. Yeah, The Big Wheel by Chris Burden from like 71. Yeah.
Very well considered answer.
You know, like lowbrow, speaking of lowbrow and like car culture from like the hot rod culture, do you know Ed Roth and his like rap? Cool. Yeah.
I have a lot of, I tinker with pinstriping and hand lettering and things as well. I have an Instagram for myself and an Instagram for Pilote Studios. And you can see some of that in both of those. But yeah, I grew up loving those guys. Like that's why I was drawing and painting. I was Ken Howard is Von Dutch. That's his real name is Kenneth Howard. That's kind of been butchered by his daughters later on down with like the trucker hats in the garbage. But he was like an amazing machinist of weapons and guns out of his bus. And but he's known for his striping and Robert Williams, not Robin Williams, Robert Williams. He's a car, LA car guy, kind of does lowbrow stuff and tries to sell it as highbrow art and succeeds in a lot of respects. I have friends that some of his work was on the who am I hating list. Basically, there's a huge fiberglass sculpture of a waiter holding a tray with a fiberglass donkey with a diamond sticking out of its ass. And I love the sculpture because I think it was hilarious. And some people just thought it was too over the top and too lowbrow. But yes, I do look at those guys. I have a lot of old time video, black and white video of some of their work and what they are doing. I think most, when you think of pinstriping like that, my dad was a body man, like I said. So when we started working with pinstripes, you know, they're kind of, for people that don't understand, they're like these kind of nice curved lines and you think it's like this certain type of, you know, beautiful enhancement, but what it really started as when you were doing custom bodywork, and you can think of a grinder has like a 6-inch disc or a 4-inch disc on it, and you're grinding the material, it makes these kind of arcs. And so in certain places, if you weren't a great body man and you overlooked those things and you finished your paint job, you would have these kind of overarching grinder marks. So instead of like just it being a problem, they would enhance it with this. So you ended up having a layer of paint that kind of hides a depression of a grinder mark. So there's like, I think there's like beautiful side of craftsmanship where you're like amazing, flawless. And then there's like, okay, what do I do about this? And like, I talk about with friends of mine that are really interested in craft, I talk about using like the perfect enough and not meaning it's good enough, but like material intentionality and using it for a reason or to enhance meaning or to add inherent meaning to the project. So I think things like that, when you unravel like this beautiful, did you see what that guy can do with a paint, you know, a pinstriping brush, and then you kind of undercut it with, you know, you're covering grinder marks because you were insufficient in fixing this. And that's kind of like telling the dirty laundry, but like it still doesn't undermine the beauty of what he did with his hand with the. So there's like this give and take where, you know, I hope to strive with my work when, you know, if I flip it over and you can see the ugly, nasty underpinnings or like what I had to you know, prop an area up to get the form that I wanted, like I would still want to flip it back over and not let the project unravel. You know what I mean? You're still like, shit, that looks so bad on the inside, but I can't stop thinking about how good it looks on the outside. So I think the more you dig on people, like you're saying, Ratfink, there's some cool undercurrents that are interesting to think about, and how process, because it's like, it's failing like 1,000 times to get to like the one time that was awesome. You know what I mean? Or like, and that's what I said about happy accidents. I was like, if you look back through my work in like 2010, I was doing these rolled sheet metal. It was like right around the oil spill time. I was doing these like formed metal miniature quarter scale oil barrels. And I was actually building this form to a table that I built to display so that everything fit nice and perfectly. And I pulled the one piece off. It's called pour estimation 3, and to weld the bottom and finish out the bottoms, and it stood on its own, but it held the table. Like, that's something that I could never foresee that was going to happen. And that was a happy accident that the material just said, you can do this. And it, and like the other two, there's two others in that series, but like those just kind of float off into nothingness, and the like materially awesome problem or happening was the best thing that could ever happen. And I never planned that. You know what I mean?
I mean, that's solid advice in and of itself as well. It's just sort of letting the studio and the piece guide you sometimes. Thank you so much for your time, Taylor. It's really been a pleasure to hear about your work.
Yeah, thank you guys so much. Obviously, during these times, like I said, you know, having work hanging on the wall that I didn't know when I was going to necessarily get to getting the material or getting it shipped or when it would come, to have it here, and I've been using it since I got it here, the funding and people backing it. On top of that, having the interviews and kind of, you know, using these new forms of conversation, obviously like Zoom, and getting people out there and, you know, hopefully meeting other artists. Anybody can come to the studio. I'm always open. I'm here often, and letting anybody come through. I'll be open, and a couple of the artists in here will be open for open studios when that happens. So I'm always open to sharing tools, sharing knowledge, sharing a beer, sharing the space. So if anybody's out there, this is a nice personable way to say hi.
Definitely. We're really excited to see what you do, and sincerely, congratulations. We're very happy to be able to support you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was an honor to talk to you.
Definitely.
Thanks a lot.
Take care. Be safe.
Thank you. You as well.